Thank you. It is 9:55 and we will reconvene, and we have a second reading and a resolution. The first of which is GA08-16.
I guess I have to get back to work.
Yep.
Okay, so this is GA-08-16, which is the second reading of an ordinance that I'll read by title only. An ordinance of the City of Punta Gorda, Florida, amending Punta Gorda Code Chapter 10, Yard Waste, Solid Waste, and Recycling, Article Roman numeral 2, Solid Waste, Section 10-11, Fees for Removal and Disposal Generally, to increase the monthly fee for removal and disposal of residential curbside recycling services, providing for conflict and severability, and providing an effective date.
This is a second reading.
Yeah, second reading puts into effect the 75-cent increase for recycling. We talked about it during the budget process.
Mm-hmm. Move approval, GA0816.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve GA0816. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried unanimously. And next we have SV03-16, and I did receive two cards, but I'll let you read these.
Okay. And this is a resolution of the City Council of the City of Punta Gorda, Florida, declaring its intent to consider vacating certain portions of Maud Street, Red Esplanade, Maud Park, and Crosby Park, more particularly described in Exhibits A1, A2, A3, A4, and A5, attached hereto and made a part thereof, requesting a recommendation from the Planning Commission and fixing a public hearing thereon.
Go ahead.
This is part of the process that we signed an agreement with Fisherman's Village regarding the land sale. So this just sets into motion the intent to vacate, and then we'll go through the process like we do other vacations.
There'll be other public hearings to follow.
Yes.
So we do have two cards. So first I'll take Mike McKinley and then Patty Allen.
Mrs. Allen said she has to go first.
Okay, Mrs. Allen.
Thank you. Patty Allen, General Manager of Fisherman's Village. Yes, as Howard stated, that it is part of what we ultimately want to do is close on the land, and we are certainly ready to close on the land. Just to give you an update, our bathrooms are being remodeled, and we've had to change contractors. My question to you all, and I'm not sure if this is the right form, but since we're talking about Fisherman's Village, I'm going to bring it up. We had to switch contractors. Does that mean that I have to come back again to you all? Even the footprint is not changing. The footprint still remains the same. It has to be turned into the permitting department. Does that still need to come back to you for consent?
As long as the design is the same as what council approved.
Yes.
You would need to notify the building department, you know, obviously officially that the contractor has been changed, so they have somebody else to be looking after, but mm-hmm. It would not need to come back before the city council.
Okay, thank you. And then we're also here if you have any questions about anything with this. I'm happy, or our attorney, Mr. McKinley, is happy to answer any technical questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Patty.
Okay.
Move approval.
I would just like to point out that once this process is completed, the city will be receiving a substantial sum of money from Fisherman's Village.
Move approval, SV0316.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve SV03-16. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried unanimously. Okay, yeah. Next we're going to move into the consent agenda, and I did receive a couple cards for one of the items. But would any council members like to pull any items for consideration? Tom?
I would like to pull E4 just so the public can see the intent of the yarn bomb at the Hector House Plaza.
Okay, and those are the two cards that I did receive. So any other items to pull? So let's open citizens' comments on consent agenda other than yarn bombing. Would anybody like to speak on any consent agenda item that is not the yarn bomb? Seeing none, I will entertain a motion.
Move approval of the remaining consent agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda without E4. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried unanimously. So let's go into E4. Do you want to give a little open, a little opening. Oh, Terry is? Okay, and then we'll take the two cards and anybody else who would like to speak on it, and then proceed.
I didn't know what a yarn bomb was until we went through this, and I think the public might be interested.
We didn't know what it was either. We're showing pictures of what it could be.
I like it.
I'd never heard anything until I got a phone call from a resident.
I know.
My wife's involved in it, so I can't say anymore. It's just a fun deal.
We've got Jerry here. Maybe he wants to say a couple words.
Hi, Jerry Brusheller, President of Downtown Merchants Association. I have a couple of the yarn bombers with me today, and I'd like to show you one of our examples we're going to have. Darla, you want to come here? This is going to be our Santa Claus. It's going to be wrapped around a palm tree. Oh. And you can picture this. I'll be the tree.
Oh, they're all working.
No, I was going to be the tree. I'll be the tree.
You're going to be the tree. See, his arms here so the kids will be able to get a hug from Santa Claus. That'll be wrapped around the palm tree.
Uh-huh.
So it's just something that's very colorful and interesting and different. And we'll keep it up from December 1st through the holidays. Then take it down, and then maybe talk about doing something for another holiday. We'll see how it goes.
Thank you. Any Debbie questions? Is...
That's me.
Would you like to speak, too? Would you like to say anything?
My name's Deborah Schultes, and I haven't been sworn in, but that's okay.
That's okay.
It just was an idea we came up with in our yarn club, and it can be very colorful, very bright, and it won't harm any of the environment. It's removable, and we just thought we'd try it.
Thank you.
I love it.
Nancy?
Yeah, the first question I asked was, are you going to put any holes in the palms of the trees? And the answer was no. Things will be hanging from them, but not in any way damaging the trees. So it's a very positive thing. And we'll see how much fun we can have with this.
I just want to say, first of all, Debbie, thank you for bringing it to my attention. And this was a while back, and I mentioned it to Howard, and then we got the process going. My wife's involved in it. I would encourage, this is just a fun community project. You can go on the internet. Lots of communities are doing this. It's festive. It's irreverent. It's just sweet. And thank you very much. I'm glad you brought the idea.
Thank you. I think it would be a draw downtown. I mean, a great photo op, you know, now everybody's Snapchat, selfies, all that stuff. If you could get a couple Pokemon in there too, you know, high trees, you could get all kinds of people down there to look at your yarn. Tom?
I'd like to move approval of E4.
Second.
We have a motion second to approve E4. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Thank you, folks.
Get to work. Yeah. Okay, regular agenda. Now would be the time if you would like to speak on the strategic plan, the resolution of the interlocal agreement between the city and the county for the library property, the sale of the West Henry Street property. The new business would be discussion regarding future use of the 7 parking spaces near West Virginia Avenue, future level of service for legal services. And I do have a couple cards, so I'll call these people first. Julie McGilvray, Julie Moriarty, and then Darcy Hall. If you guys would like to be the first three speakers, and then anybody else who would like to speak on any of the regular agenda topics, you will be given 3 minutes. It is not a question and answer session. It's just a public comment period. So we'll go with Julie.
Good morning. It's great to see everyone again. Mrs. Mayor, respected council members, staff, and fellow residents, I feel blessed to be a resident of one of the prettiest little cities in Southwest Florida. I'm sure pretty much everybody else feels the same way. I think what makes this town so special is its waterfront living, friendly neighbors, but also the fact that we've stymied out of growth control as well. I'm here to oppose the selling off of public land. The Henry Street parcel is nearly identical in size to the Gilcrest Park. Gilcrest is 12 acres, Henry Street is 11 acres, actually. A lot of people think that History Park is just that small cluster of homes that we've all come to enjoy and realize. But actually, it's a little bit larger than that. According to the 2025 comprehensive plan, as well as the 2040 comprehensive plan, it's actually described as being 9 acres. The 2025 plan and the 2040 plan, if you actually look it up, the area in question, the Henry Street development, is actually part of History Park. So I just wanted to call everyone's attention to that. The plan does, in the 2025 plan, this area is not listed as vacant city land, but rather it's actually listed as a park. So it's an undeveloped park, but a park nonetheless. As a result of having this land available, we've been able to have our library land made available, which is a great gem in community, community gardens as well. So since Hurricane Charlie, we've actually had 3 uses of this land. If we didn't have land, then we wouldn't have library going up. So I just wanted to say that the only thing that is guaranteed here is the one-time check. Future tax revenue streams are not guaranteed. So I just wanted to point that out. I just want to implore the council to reject this proposal, and together with citizens groups, like we saw this morning with the $100,000 check for Friends of Gilchrist Playground, we can make this a valuable community space that we're all proud of. Thank you.
Thank you. So we have Julie Moriarty, and then Darcy Hall, and then whoever else would like to speak as well.
Julie Moriarty, City of Punta Gorda. I'd like to go on record as being a proponent to keep the park green space, but in the event that the council members choose to vote to sell it, I'd like to address the proposal that the developer included along with the offer to purchase the property. The developer is planning on building, according to them, homes ranging from a 2-bedroom, 2-bath, 1,700 square foot, to a 3-bedroom, 2.5-bath, 2,200 square foot. The lot sizes are 55 by 100 feet, which are very small lots. They say that they intend to sell these for a price starting at about $450,000. I've been in construction all my life, over 35 years, and I'm well aware of what it takes to develop, build, and complete projects like this. My primary concern about this is the request that they have regarding timing. They say that in their timing, they would require that we maintain, we being the developers, maintain complete flexibility on when we construct our homes and the velocity to which we build them. If these homes don't sell within a rather quick time period, what we'll have is we could have a white elephant there, where there's this space where they have their 6 model homes originally built, as according to the proposal, and then maybe nothing goes, because at the $450,000, we're looking at homes that are not on canals. So I would hope that the council looks very seriously at the timing that they are requesting in their proposal, and consider that in the event that they choose to go ahead with the sale of the property. Thank you.
Thank you. Darcy Hall.
Hi, I'm Darcy Hall, and I don't have any paperwork or anything official. It's just that we have that green space left in the historic part of Punta Gorda, and if we let it be developed, it's gone forever. Forever. And our community is going to continue to grow, and we need to keep the green space for parks and things like the library. I just, forever is a heck of a long time, and to just put cement, there's a lot of different places to build houses, but we need our green space and our park space. So that's just my vote.
Thank you. Anybody else like to speak public comments on any of the regular agenda items? Please.
Oh yes, we're not done. Gary Skillicorn, Punta Gorda. I guess I don't pick up on too many causes, but this one certainly has touched my heart. Again, maybe a recent resident, 4 years in Punta Gorda, but there's a reason why I chose Punta Gorda. I like it. And yes, I know we're all destined for change in the future. We have to accept it. But in moderation and things that we ought to do wisely, one of the things that was done is in the last few days since the agenda item came out on this, we did go out with a petition. Within 3 days, we got 160 names and signatures associated with it. What I'd like to do is to hand out a summary, including comments, if I may. I'd be happy to give up the rest of my time for you to take a look at it. But just a couple quick points. I know that I've sent emails to the council and Howard a couple different times, and I hope you had a chance to look at that, so I won't try to reiterate what I did. It's a real diamond in the rough. I see opportunities here in the future. We didn't know we were going to put a library there. We didn't know the dog park was going to be there, the community gardens. We have a plot of green land right now that I'd like to keep there. As far as appraisal, I'm not sure if any of you looked at it. I'd like to buy some of that land myself at about $30,000 for a lot, $120,000 an acre. Do you really believe that? I don't think it passed the smell test in my mind. So again, take a look at that. I do remember a few months ago that this council dealt with a pickleball problem. And I remember specifically that the city was directed or asked to look at other locations. Well, they came up looking at the top of the parking garage to put a pickleball court, because presumably we don't have any land available for pickleball. I'm not saying necessarily pickleball, it's the thing we want to do, but it's, again, in the future opportunities to look good utilization of that land. We have it, we lose it, it'll be gone forever. Lastly, I guess what I'd like to do is refer back to the comprehensive plan, element number 5, recreation and open space. If I can just read one short line from it. As Punta Gorda's population grows, it's important that the quality of existing facilities improve, as well as increasing the recreation and open space to meet the needs of communities as a whole. Let's save some green space. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else like to speak on regular agenda? Please make your way toward the podium. State your name. You have 3 minutes.
Good morning. My name is Deborah Griffith, and without belaboring the point, I would say that I support Darcy and I support Gary. I signed the petition through the Nextdoor access that we had to get to it. Been here 2 years full time. Love the fact that you can run and pick different places and head down into the park, or turn and go down past Henry. That's why we moved here too. And I would like to echo their concerns, is that once that green space is gone, it's gone. Right now, we don't know what else we want to do with it, but once we have sold it and there are homes on there, there's nothing else. You know, amongst my friends, my little boating friends say, why don't we think about an outdoor music venue? That kind of thing. We have music going on all over the city, but no central stage kind of thing. I agree. Once it's gone, it's gone. I also think if it's going to go, I'm with Gary. I want part of it for $1.5 million. The lots over on Jamaica Way sell for almost $1 million a piece. So I think it's way undervalued in terms of the local area. And please don't let our green space go. Just, there's got to be someplace else to put these homes. Thank you.
Make your way to the podium, please.
Good morning, Council. Jeff Carmen, Punta Gorda. I don't have anything to add to what these folks have already said. They made very good arguments. There's this theory of strength in numbers. I don't know if these people would come up here and argue against it or for it. I'm a opponent of it, and I thought I'd come up to the podium and be one of the few people that came up today to speak against it. So I just wanted to state my objection to it, and hopefully these people here are interested enough that if they're an objection to it, they come up and say so. Thank you.
Thank you. Make your way.
Good morning. I'm Brad Gamblin, and I am concerned about the Henry Street sale of potential, or actually of park property. I too am surprised that the council and city are considering selling that last area in that area piece of Greenland. I don't really understand why. Once gone, as many have said, it's gone for good. And I really don't know, as I said, why. I would like to thank the wisdom of previous councils who held on to that land, that green space, which is now our library, and who had the foresight at times which were a little tougher economically for the city of Punta Gorda than they are now, certainly, and really had the foresight to say, we are not going to sell that last bit of green space for a quick profit at this time, because we don't know what the future might bring or the needs that might come in the future. And I think they had the right idea. We don't know the needs of the future, although I think we're beginning to see them. The idea that was just promoted about maybe a band shell down there, there's a lot of entertainment ideas, or just simply having green space is enough for me. I am surprised at this. I don't think we have a real shortage of land at this point for homes in the area of Punta Gorda Isles. There are hundreds and hundreds of empty lots available. They are selling. Houses are being built. We really don't need another development, especially one that takes the last of our green space. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Please make your way to the podium.
My name is Thomas Lingauer, a little hoarse this morning. I live at 1250 West Marion Avenue, right next to Fisherman's Village. I've been a resident of Punta Gorda for about 18 years. At that time, we did not know we needed a new library. Thank heavens that we have space for that new library. We did not have a dog park at that time. That park is used on a regular basis. At the time I moved here, I had no idea that space was ever going to be utilized. And I don't know if 20 years from now that we're going to have some other item that's pertaining to the benefit of all the residents of Punta Gorda, what space is going to be needed. If we give it away now, if we sell it, we will not have that option available to us. And I believe a reconsideration should be given to that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Please make your way to the podium if you would like to speak.
Hi, my name is Mike Slattery. I'm from the Boston area, and I've watched overdevelopment and thoughtless development over the years. And the thing that separates Punta Gorda Isles from Fort Myers is green space, and I don't want to call it underdevelopment, but thoughtful development that doesn't take away the quality of this wonderful neighborhood that we have. Yeah, I've seen it happen before. Don't let it happen.
Anybody else? Last call. Okay, we will move into the regular agenda. First item we have under the budget is the fiscal year 2017 strategic plan.
What we have done since our last meeting on August 24th, we've made changes that you requested in the strategic plan. The strategic plan goes hand in hand with our budget adoption tonight. It sets forth the action items that you're going to want us to undertake over the next fiscal year. There are a couple of items that are still in there that I'd like to just raise to your attention to see if you still want them in there. When we leave stuff in the items in the strategic plan, it means as a staff, we're going to do something. And we're going to bring it back to you. And it may or may not cause more angst in the public. But the reason we bring it back to you is that it's in the strategic plan. So, the first item I want to raise is that, and again, these are holdovers from previous strategic plans. One of the action items is that as a city, we are going to encourage the location of a performing arts center in the city. As a city, between the city council and staff, we need some direction as to what exactly we as a city are going to do to accomplish that. And if not, do we really need that in the strategic plan?
I would say no. Kim?
I would say no. I think our encouragement is just if someone wants to do it, we're going to encourage them.
Can we just say that? We're still encouraging, even though it's not written in the strategic plan.
We'll be welcoming.
Yeah, and we will still support them. I mean, we have all kinds of initiatives that pop up, and our staff is extremely gracious in assisting community organizations in researching and providing support.
I mean, it really falls into the under the quality of life in a general enhance and promote Punta Gorda's attractive neighborhoods and working environment, heritage tourism, cultural opportunities, healthy ecosystem and outdoor lifestyle. It's kind of in there without specifically calling that out. Tom?
Well, if somebody puts it on next year's giving challenge and come up with the money for it, that's not in the budget. It's a great concept. We should support it, but not leave it in the strategic plan.
I think if let's just say some philanthropist in the community were to come forward and say that he would like, but he would need a piece of property to put this in front, or she, excuse me, a person, a great philanthropist of, and then we would certainly, as a council, I would suspect, do everything we could to jump through hoops to cooperate and find them an appropriate location, wherever that might be. At this point in time, though, I don't think it's prudent for us to try to look for the monies. And just to encourage somebody out there to come forward.
So
you got that.
So we're going to take it out.
Take it out.
I mean, of course, if somebody comes forward, if a group comes forward, if a bunch of groups come forward, we're going to work with them because that's an asset.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But, okay, so we'll take it out of the strategic plan. The other item that is in there, the next council meeting, we are going to be bringing you the probably the second or third revision of a bicycle capital improvements plan. And it's a downsized version based on previous discussions that we've had. Still in there, though, is the action item that we will continue to work towards bicycle, the requirements needed for a bicycle-friendly community. We will continue to do that. It's in the strategic plan. The capital projects are just a part of that. Do you still want to leave that in there?
I mean, I think as far as the process goes, we've slowed it down a lot. You know, it's decelerated instead of accelerated, but we are basically focused right now on the capital improvement piece of it. So maybe to reword the item. But there are, you know, there is still value to those because there's, you know, work been done on all of those areas. So, Nancy?
Yeah, as I read that particular item, you know, it doesn't say that we are going to seek the designation. It just, to me, it says that we're going to use this expertise of another organization to help guide us. So I don't really have a problem with what's in there.
I just came back from a trip to Colorado, and I was at both Boulder and Estes Park, which are really bicycle-friendly communities. We're undertaking the concept of branding and promoting the generalness of Punta Gorda, and I see this as an integral part, whether we're official or not. I think we have made a commitment to go in this direction generally, and I think it should just stay.
I'd like to see us continue in that direction and just be cognizant of our funding and what we have, funds we have available, and if we have some opportunities down the road, I'd like to see us move forward.
I agree.
Okay. So we'll leave it in. With that, we staff recommends that council adopt the strategic plan.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion, a second, to adopt the strategic plan
with the changes today.
The right. One change, basically.
Well, the one change we made today, and the other changes.
Okay.
The other changes.
With the incorporated changes. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried unanimously. Okay. Next, we have unfinished business.
And this is a resolution, which I'll read by title only. A resolution of the City Council of the City of Punta Gorda, Florida, approving the interlocal agreement between the City and Charlotte County for site remediation at 401 Shreve Street and providing an effective date.
This is being brought back by Councilmember Kavanaugh. This is the site remediation interlocal agreement. Staff and the county have worked out language. There are some little tweaking of the language. The major tweak was that if there is some disagreement, whatever it might be, the county administrator and city manager will get together, work it out within 3 days. That was requested by the county commissioners. We don't have an issue with that at all. But it's being back for consideration. Again, as a staff, we're ready to get started.
So I just have a question, because I got to reading the environmental report. Is this county driven? Did they decide on the process as far as, you know, because there are other methods to figure out what's really underneath there without having to dig the whole entire piece out and sift and refill?
We brought up another possible method, but it was, in their views, more costly.
So more costly?
More costly.
Okay. Because this is pretty costly, but.
Could be, yes, could be.
Well, we're guaranteeing that we're going to remove pretty much everything and refill. So.
And they're supplying the fill. We're doing the work of removing.
And then we're paying, what, half of the bill to the engineering company?
Well, no, what we're doing is we're going to have to rent some special equipment for sifting and also for digging some of the dirt out if our equipment can't handle it, which we don't think all of it we can. We gave you an estimate of what our in-kind and actual costs might be, which is up to $75,000 is an estimate. That's going to be our participation in the project. We talked about it the last meeting.
So other options were explored.
Our city engineer brought up another option. If he's in the cry room and he wants to come out and discuss it.
Whoa, there he is.
Good morning, Mark Gehring, Public Works. Yes, we did discuss with the county project manager the options of a grade beam, which is a concrete beam under the building in case there were any settlement, or cast piles, and they said that they were way out of the ballpark in cost compared to the $75,000 estimate that we had.
You need a motion.
Well, at our last meeting, we halted. I believe we halted our involvement with the county in this interlocal agreement, and I wanted to speak to that. I think we did that, and without making our position clear as to what we expect the new library to be, to look like, and I think that we ought to clarify that the city council should clarify its position on what we expect from the building to look like, or what, you know, before we just pull the plug on a project and on this part of the project anyway.
So what do you suggest we do?
Well, I had some thoughts that we should let the commissioners know. We've already let them know with my letter that we'd like the library to continue to be named the Punta Gorda Library. I think that it should be made clear that we expect them to comply with the full intent of the city's land development regulations in terms of how the building should look. And I think that we should make it clear to them that the grant money, the $500,000 in grant money, that if it becomes available, should be utilized to accommodate what the community clearly wants, and that's an enhanced appearance and some other interior partitions from, is what I understand as well. So I think that we ought to define what we expect as a city council.
And attach it to this resolution, or?
Well, I'm not sure of the protocol.
If you're inclined to approve the resolution, we can include that as another letter under the mayor's signature on behalf of city council. We already did one naming it on a glare library.
I just, you know, go ahead, Kim.
I've talked to several of the commissioners, and what you're saying, I've made it clear my feelings to them, just so you know. in agreement with what you have.
Mm-hmm. I've done the same thing, and I seem to get the similar responses, but I feel as if what we've done is act in good faith, and I think that just to restate in good faith what we have done as partners in a collaborative process all along, our intention in the very beginning when we started this process, and you know, why we've done it, and not as written as a demand, but it's really a collaborative process, and why we are continuing in good faith to do what we're going to do.
And I think we should just continue one-on-one with those conversations. Another letter is, I just don't feel appropriate at this time. I just don't.
But I'd like to move approval.
Do we have a second? Okay, we have a motion, a second to approve the resolution. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried unanimously. Okay, next we have discussion of the sale and development of the West Henry Street property.
Before we will continue to discuss with the county staff, and they've been working really well with us on the library. They really have. We will continue to express what we're looking for. We're not.
Do the best you can.
We're involved. We're involved over there. Yeah.
Okay. So, West Henry.
Can you give a little history? It's been in the strategic plan.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Talk about what this was.
Okay. For many, many years, the West Henry Street property was the site of the Public Works and utilities complex. You had fleet there. You had fleet management there, a fleet building. You had our warehouse. You had canal maintenance there. You had public works crews. You had public works administration. You had utilities crews. You had utilities administration. You had utility billing and customer service building. That was there. That was the site prior to Hurricane Charlie. That was the site after Hurricane Charlie for a number of years. It didn't look so good. And you had a lot of city trucks and vehicles in and out of that site. We did get comments from the neighborhood about the traffic that we were causing in that area. So back in 2007, we did an appraisal, and we went out for proposals, and we got a proposal to do a land swap. And that land swap was going to relocate our public works and utilities activities to the airport area. And in return, the proposer was going to be putting in a mixed-use village on that site, a mixed-use village, residential, commercial, in a village-type setting. If any of you have been to Celebration outside of Orlando, it's a very nice little village concept. We discussed it, and that did not come to fruition because at the same time frame, we also the proposer found some property off of Cooper Street at a really reasonable rate because they were in foreclosure. And we moved the Public Works Utilities Complex to a site off of Cooper Street where they are today. We moved billing and collection into City Hall where they are today. And actually that proved out to be even better than the land swap. It was a very favorable deal. We use 1% sales tax dollars to relocate them. And the property became open. And it's been open since 2010. Approximately 2010. It's been open for about 6 years in green space. So we have the dog park there. We have History Park. We have land for the a new community garden that was just built. And that's going to be the site of the new library. We also put the linear park. City Council's over the last 6 years, it has been in our strategic plan, it's been out of our strategic plan, it's been in and out, to take a look at that site to see if we put it out there on the street for proposals, what could we garner? What would be, what kind of proposals could we get that might fit within the neighborhood for that piece of property? At one time, we put out their proposals for realtors to market the site. And after a discussion at a council meeting, public comments, we pulled back. We didn't do that. We talked about, a few years later, about again going out for proposals. It was in the strategic plan. We decided not to do it. This time, it was in the strategic plan again. We put it out there, and we received one proposal back. We discussed it at a previous council meeting. The proposal was for 54 single-family homes on 10 or 11-plus acres, plus or minus acres. And the council at that time said, we need to get an appraisal, and let's all sit down with the proposer to see in a little more detail what we're talking about. So we went out and got an appraisal. You have the appraisal in front of you. It's an independent appraisal. It's close to what the offer was for the sale of the property. And sitting down with the developer proposer, he brought to the meeting an engineering firm, and we were going over ideas. And at one point, we finally said, you know, it's really not fair to the developer that they be paying fees for engineering services when we don't even know, as a city council, has not firmly decided whether or not we even want to sell the property. We need to make that decision first. It's not fair to a developer or proposer to spend money on something they're not sure is going to happen. So in front of you today, and we can show you two different concepts, and that's what they are. The first concept. There we go. Okay, keeps the dog park where it is. And in the green is about 40 single-family homes. 40. The second concept relocates the dog park to that location right over there. Now, that's problematic as well, but it's possible. There are some homes there. And increases the number of lots to about 54, thereabout. These are just concepts. The wet pond is a for stormwater retention, and the idea was if we decided to go this route, we would have the developer sit down with the county folks and work out if we can come up with a mutual agreement so that both projects can share in a retention area and save some dollars. But we're not there yet. So what's in front of you is, first, accept the appraisal. It is what it is. The number came close to what the offer is. And the second decision for City Council is, do you as a council want to further our discussions with the developer for single family development, which is a downsized from what is currently allowed? Currently is allowed 15 units per acre, and depending on what we go with, it's going to be less than 5 units an acre. Do you feel a single family development is appropriate for the site, or do you want to just keep it open for now and look at our options in the future? I think we owe it to the community and we owe it to the developer to make that answer first.
I mean, it is by neighborhood, and the 6 years I've sat up here, we've really considered it surplus property. I know we did agree to put the library there, but I mean, people say, well, we wouldn't have a library. Well, the county would have found a place to build the library, but we definitely wanted to try to keep it in the city of Punta Gorda if we could. When I read the appraisal, just looking at the zoning and what potentially could go there, I really like the proposal that is in front of us. I think it makes a lot of sense. I think it would be a beautiful neighborhood for Punta Gorda, but I guess the policy call is, do we want to hang on to it, or do we, you know, want to let it go? That's the call today. I think in the past, councils have really been skittish with the market conditions that are out there, but it seems like what we've gotten back today is in line with the appraisals. So I'm kind of on the fence, so to say, here. I think if we do decide to keep it, it's going to be for the long term. And with that is going to be, you know, more requests for parks and facilities and restrooms. And, you know, we already put the linear park there, and it's beautiful. The landscaping, the maintenance, the benches, the garbage cans. I mean, just thinking off the top of my head right now, we need two new restroom facilities at Gilchrist. We need new restrooms at, which are not cheap, we found out, restrooms at Ponce. We need new restrooms there. They're not going to be cheap. History Park has requested restroom facilities. So, I mean, unless we want to really expand our parks budget in the future, 1% sales tax is not guaranteed. It's a referendum. It's going to be heavy on the taxpayers to support all these parks. I mean, all along PGI, we have parks all along the waterfront there on Park Beach Circle, on Retta. I mean, there are multiple parks in Punta Gorda. So to turn this whole area into a park, for me, would be a real financial burden, I would say, because we have so much park infrastructure right now. Kim?
I agree with you. I mean, I would like nothing more to have another beautiful park. That would be great. But to support that kind of parkland when our city is surrounded by parks, I've been here for 20 years, and I remember this when the Public Works was there. And I was a member of, at the time, it was called Old Punta Gorda, Inc. And Don Atwell decided that we needed a history park. And my husband at the time and I donated the cigar cottage that was moved there, and subsequently other buildings were moved there. And we were out there with you know, maybe 10, 12 residents every Saturday and Sunday cleaning bricks that Rick Treewergy donated for the sidewalks. So it was very much a community project, and that's how that kind of came together. And then the dog park. And of course, the Public Works was right next door, and the city council at the time, when they gave us that property, it was like, the Public Works is there, let them put their history park there. It was really not expected to be the wonderful place that it is today, for sure. And then the dog park. I love the homes idea. I just see, because I represent the business district, that we need more rooftops to support our community businesses year-round. We need people here, and if you're involved in real estate at all, the price tag of $400,000 or $450,000, those will be snapped up. I mean, it's hard to find a place. I mean, a lot of the homes are aging, so people are looking for them. I mean, these cute little cottages with the front porches and the metal roofs, I mean, I think they're beautiful. I mean, there's a lot to consider, but do we need another park is what's in my mind.
Nancy?
I would agree with the question, do we need another park? But I see this differently, in that we have found uses for particular portions of the space. And I see this as we don't know what's coming. We have a lot of things happening with Western Michigan coming. There are developers who are really looking at this community. We've caught the attention of people with the redevelopment of the Colonial Burnt Store, a Promenade Shopping Center. Mm-hmm. There are other developers looking at the out parcels there for things that I think will delight this community. And I think that we may find other needs for that space. And I'm not saying that it's going to be residential. We may find other needs for this space that to satisfy some of the future needs and that we yet have not identified. So for me, I think it's something that we should not jump to convert into housing space at this time.
to just hold on to it?
I would, yes.
I have a couple questions, not being a developer. And I think there's some questions have been raised about the appraisal versus what lots normally go for in the area, that this would be a great investment and so forth. But it would seem to me, and I'm just asking for clarification, if I go buy a single lot somewhere in Punta Gorda, I already have a road and I already have a lot of utilities and a lot of asset already to that lot. Whereas in this particular parcel, I would assume that this developer is going to be providing that asset. And so that's also value added that he's required to do. So yeah, it's not a $75,000 lot like it might be a block away where there's already a street. So I want to clarify that. I also want to point out one other aspect of history there is we still have our lift station there, and this used to be the waste treatment plant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Oh. And this is still the lift station for the waste treatment plant. And it does have waste treatment asset there, particularly with odor control, et cetera, that we have discussed recently with the contract and so forth. And here's a developer that, as I understand, this is a partnership between some people in Chicago and a local builder, and there is real funds here. This isn't a local entrepreneur. There are some deep pockets there. So if they were to start the project, they're going to complete it. And that's their intent. So I'm sitting a little bit on the fence, but I'm more inclined to say that with everything else that we've got going, with the park issues that are the park developments that are already in that neighborhood, that we may not need more park here, and that this would be a prudent venture for us to consider as a council.
Tom?
Over the past 10, possibly 12 years, there has not been a city council that has occupied these seats that has not dealt with a budget deficit each and every year. When we first decided to consider this, it was during the June-July timeframe when we were dealing with our own budget shortfall for the year. And that's kind of what influenced me to support sending it out for the appraisal. However, thinking that some condition that we do anticipate some money coming into the city, I think that the revision to the annexation policy that we just approved in our strategic plan will be beneficial to the city down the road in providing rooftops and rooftops that will be in the city. And for that reason, I would like to keep that property the way it is for now until we see what we could use it for, how it might be developed in the future. That's my feeling on it.
So, I mean, I guess devil's advocate to that is that if we hang on to it now, when is the right time? You know, I think we really need to make a call whether we keep it or we decide, you know, keep it for public. Keep it for, you know, future public uses, or if we sell it. So I think that's the call now, because if we keep it open the way it is now, then it's going to be expected to stay that way. Nancy?
I would, the way I look at this is there may be a need and we may end up carving a part of this for a particular purpose. And I'm not looking at park space necessarily. I mean, there could be something associated with another, it could be a public kind of a structure. It could be something related to Western Michigan or whoever. I mean,
performing arts.
It could be performing arts. It could be whatever. That's possible. I just don't see that it's. And I know the expectation of new residents, because they haven't been here, they don't know the history, mm-hmm. So they see this as green space, and the residents just assume that that's what this is, when in fact that's not what it's been, and that it's been my perception that councils haven't acted because of the economy was keeping
yes,
things
that
down.
Was a major mm-hmm. consideration, is the market conditions.
Market conditions.
Yep. Kim?
I can see that that could happen. I really like the idea of these little homes. It is a neighborhood already. We have a lot of public things that are there right now. And as you see, when we mix too many public things with too many residential things, residents get unhappy about that. So if we, I think the public thing that may be there may be something that people may not want there. It may be noisy. It may be too much traffic. I just think the residential, that small little, those small little cottages are, it's a perfect
fit. And along that line, I mean, we've even had to make improvements to the dog park. We've had to put up the fencing and do some other things because because it's adjacent to a residential neighborhood.
I mean, it'd be a very desirable place with the dog park, with the library, with all of those public
amenities. And walking distance,
too. All the walking, the linear parks, the harbor walk. It just seems like the quietest. I mean, a lot of people have said pickleball. That won't go there because it's a neighborhood.
Yeah, we'll face the same challenges we have with our other pickleball court over there.
Make a motion to approve the sale.
Well,
sorry.
Approve further negotiations.
Further negotiations.
Mm-hmm. So we have a motion. Do we have a second? Okay, we don't have a second. So do we have any other motions?
I'll make a motion that we don't, that we do not act on this at this time. And retain the property for future determination.
I'll second that.
So we have a motion. I'm going to use it. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Opposed.
Opposed. 3-2.
I apologize. Who was the second?
Nice.
Tom.
Okay, next we will move on to new business.
So, based on that, we, I know we already approved the strategic plan. Can I take it out? Can we take it out of the strategic plan?
Take it out.
Yes, take it out.
Okay. The next item is, we're getting it up on the screen. We've been approached by the owners.